Aloha, everybody. This is Tyler, and we are on a casual Master Quest side quest. We're going to be doing a little special today. We're going to be interviewing Cam, a person that we know and we all love, but we don't quite know why. Currently, as my partner, interviewer slash interrogator, I have Nick over by my side. Nick, how are you doing today?
Good.
Fantastic.
A little warm, a little toasty, but good otherwise.
Good. We're going to put the heat on Cam. We are going to grill him at a nice 400, maybe a 450 degrees, because I want a little sear on him.
Yeah.
First question immediately. Cam, how do you like your steak?
Ooh, how do I like my steak? I don't need too much steak, but probably more on the rare side of things. I like some blood. I like some liveliness in the meat. So,
okay, good. Yeah. That was a bit of a blue rare grilled question for you. So just warm you up here. For those who don't know, Cam, of course, is one of our beloved co-hosts and is one of the most critical people in our team. I would say between myself, Cam, and Nick, Cam is probably the most knowledgeable when it comes to video game information. Aww. And to some extent, probably the funniest. I would like to say I'm probably at the bottom of the total poll. Nick likes to shoot these gems every now and then, but Cam always lays down the heat in such a way. Whether it's a very quick-witted joke that involves facts about the Vita, or his very high-pitched squealing when it comes to playing at Fortnite and discovering an enemy.
You're making me blush.
However, we're not here for stories. Actually, we are. But don't worry, I got 17 questions lined up so far, a couple of heavy hitters down the way. Nick is going to be helping me. Let's do this.
All right, let's roll.
Cam, question number one. Is Cam short for Cameron?
It is, yes. So it is short for Cameron.
But you don't like being called Cameron.
No, so it's a kind of a joke I've been making, which is that only the government calls me Cameron. I really don't like formality, just in a general sense. I'm not a fan of formality. I hate it to an extent. So anything short, sweet, informal, Cam, I've gone by it my entire life. It's on my school forms at this point. And yeah, my full name, I'm not a fan of it. Like, it's a decent name. I'm not like anti my name, mind you. But I just like the informality of Cam. So
okay. Off the top. So Mr. Cam Collects, you'd be like, please, that's my father's name.
Yeah. Okay. Exactly.
No, Cam Collects is my father's name. Please call me Cam.
Yep.
Do you have any other nicknames that you've been known for?
Oh, geez. I mean, there's a lot just because, you know, Cam has some stuff I can rhyme with. I remember people used to call me Camera. Some people just called me Monkey. Monkey, and a lot of my family call me Monkey because I like climbing all over the place. Okay, I don't have any cool nicknames, unfortunately, like recent cool nicknames. I could use a couple, I think. I think it'd be really rad if I had one of those nicknames, like kind of like sports people do or swimmers do and stuff, where it's like, oh, he's the Saw Shark of Rhode Island or something like that. I'd take I'd go with that. That'd be good.
We can work with something here. We got quite a few questions. There was a point where I was calling you Camelan whenever I was talking with Nick. I'm like, we got to wait for Camelan to show up. But
Camelama was a thing. Camelama Ding Dong was a thing.
Oh, man, there goes my fun then. Yeah. All right. Go ahead and interject anytime you want to, Nick, okay? Go ahead and hit that buzzer and just shoot him. Well, don't shoot him. We got to keep him alive for the interrogation. We need information.
Understandable.
Right. And also for the episode.
Sure.
Well, episodes. Not so much.
Yeah, that's true. Like I said, critical character. When were you born, Cam?
Ooh, okay. October 5th, 1994.
Wow. Yeah. I knew this question would make me feel immediately old, but that's okay.
Yeah.
It's weird because 1991, and I consider anybody super young if they're younger than my sister, which is 93. So,
okay.
You say 94, and it's like, whew.
Yeah. If I can alleviate some of the concern, I say this a lot, but I grew up with the 93s because I was very young for my class, so I probably graduated in the same year your sister did.
Okay, honorary. So, I will work with you.
Yeah, honorary 24, we'll say.
Where were you born, man?
I was born. Oh, it's Nick. Oh,
sorry. Before, I'm 95, my sister's a 2000, so
not
to make it feel older. But,
oh, my.
Let's carry on, Cap. So where I was born, in Newton, Massachusetts, Newton Wellesley Hospital, which, funny enough, I think on my dad's side of the family, my dad's side of the family's been in the U.S. for a long, long, long time, since the 1600s. Mm. And it was somewhere to the order of like 15 generations or something like that of the men in my family. My dad's side were born in that like Newton Wellesley area or something like that.
Holy smokes.
Yeah,
it was just going on
all around that area. So,
okay. Yep. This is going to go a little bit over into the video game experience.
Sweet.
Figuratively and literally, because that's the name of your podcast. What was your first video game experience?
Ooh, you know, it's tough, right? Because I don't think I was definitely... The first time I saw a video game or played it, I probably wasn't cognizant enough to remember it. But the first thing I do remember playing was my grandma and my aunt, interestingly enough, were really into NES games. And that kind of surprised me because back then it was... They were older for the time back then. So it wasn't like they were kids getting into it. My aunt was in her, I think, 20s or something when the NES came out. And so it was the scenario where they kind of had it out there. And so my first experience was probably 3 or 4 playing Duck Hunt and Mario on the NES.
Fair enough. What was your first console, though?
Ooh, my first console personally was, I believe, a Game Boy Color, 1998. And that was actually when I got Blue Version as well, because it came out right around my birthday in October. So I got Blue Version and a Game Boy Color from my aunt slash my mom. I believe they both lived with me at the time, and I can't remember exactly who gave it to me. But yeah, that, you know, that started the Pokemon brainwashing. So get it in, get it long, and been there ever since.
Were you a good kid?
No, I was terrible.
Oh, you were a terrible kid.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah.
Like, are we talking like I wouldn't walk on the sidewalk whenever I was going somewhere? Are we talking like I like to put soap on cars?
No, I was never. I was never malicious. I was never mean to other kids. My problem was I was on the opposite spectrum where I felt a lot of injustice related things. And I was like a big against authority guy. So like I was questioning my teachers, not in like a philosophical sense or anything, just being generally a snot. From preschool on. There's a famous story where apparently my preschool teacher, there was a jar of acorns in the classroom, and I brought in my own acorns, and she tried to make me put my acorns back. And of course, those are mine. She didn't believe me. She thought I was lying, but those were my acorns. Mm. So apparently, I think I might have bit her or something like that. Like,
well, that wouldn't escalate. Yeah. Quickly.
So like, it was always, I was always very stubborn, as I am now, extremely stubborn. And the only reason I'm not a giant asshole now is because people let me do what I want. That's the thing. And back in the past, yeah, definitely. No, I was a very, very loud, very wild, hard to control. A lot of calls to the homes from schools and stuff.
Chaotic good.
chaotic good is my alignment. Yeah, no, it's true.
Chaotic neutral.
I'll have my acorns good, so. And kill anybody in the way.
Very much like the squirrel from Ice Age.
Yeah, no, understand. Yeah. I guess so.
Have any pets, Cam?
No, not right now, but I did in the past. And,
what kind of pets did you have when you were a kid?
I had a cat named Scargo. And Scargo, every pet that's ever been in my family has found us rather than us picking them. So my dad has a cat right now named Spot. And Spot just kind of at our lake house just wandered in one day and we took him in. And the same thing for Scargo. We were actually on a vacation up in Maine, hence the name Scargo. And there was a cat, stray cat, I guess, that was just outside our window. I was maybe 4 or 5. And there was like a dog came up and like the cat, my cat Scargo scared off the dog. It was like a German Shepherd or something like that.
Ooh, guardian cat.
It was amazing because Scargo had never once since that point, we never heard her hiss. She never scratched anybody. She never did anything. And so we had Scargo up until like, I think 2014 or 15 when she was put down. So like 98, 99, all the way, man. Yeah.
I'm sorry to hear that, but it sounds like she lived a very big, happy life.
Yeah, she was a good kitty.
Okay, fair enough. Did you, I almost skipped a question here. I think we actually answered it, but I'm going to reiterate for the sake of time. What were you like in high school?
Oh, no, this one. Okay, this is different because high school is a different story. Ooh. So high school, man, early high school, I was... As hardcore as I am now about whatever I was into at the time, I was very fat. I was a big fatty. I was getting up to around, at my worst, I think around 240 pounds or something like that.
Okay.
And at 5'10", you know, it kind of showed. Like, I look back at pictures now and I'm like, man. But during 10th, 11th grade, right around then, I kind of got more into the internet culture full time. And I watched Gurren Lagann for the first time, an anime that I've talked about before that really changed a lot of my perspective on life. And I've carried that even up until now. And from that, high school became like my friend group and I just being the tightest of friends you could ever imagine. We knew everything about each other. We still do. Absolutely nothing off the table. We, you know, did a bunch of crazy stuff. We were all boisterous. We were all loud. We were all confident. And I actually ran a news channel as well. And it was probably some of the funnest times I've ever had in my life because we were just so wild. And everything was about like reaching new heights, surpassing the heights of humanity and stuff like that. So,
okay, this explains why you got really defensive really quickly when the topic of recommended anime, and I may have trash talked it slightly, and you win up in arms fairly quickly.
I up until 2016, I want to say I wore the drill necklace from Gurren Lagann. I had that every day. I wore every day from 2012 to 2016.
Why'd you stop? That's cool. Come on, Cam.
I lost two of them. I lost two of them. That's the only reason I stopped.
You only have two?
I've over time, over those years, I've lost two of them. But I do have one.
Like a medicine cabinet full of them at this point.
No, it's the single one that's special. See, the soul resides in that single drill. But I have a friend who made me one through metalworking back in high school, and I still have that one. I wear that to secretly to formal events to keep it going a little bit. I wore it to my college graduation actually, so I didn't tell anybody, but it was there.
No, that's fantastic. This is information I was absolutely hoping to get from you. I'm going to hit you with a heavy hitter, if you don't mind.
Oh, definitely. Let's go.
Tell me about your parents.
All right. My parents. They're awesome.
You talked about your dad, but were they together when you were born? Or?
So, interesting. So, basically, my parents never got married. So, they had never once been married, but I always found it to be a benefit because in the cases of divorce, which is very prevalent these days, generally, the parents seem to dislike each other. And because, of course, they divorced, there's always that tenderness there. But in the case of them never married, they never really got tired of each other or got on each other's nerves to an extreme extent. So it was pretty much just like having two families I jump between. And they didn't dislike each other or anything like that. You know, twice the holidays, twice the presents. The one thing I can say about my life growing up and definitely influenced who I am these days in terms of independence and being stubborn was both my parents on both ends allowed me an extreme amount of freedom from a young age. Generally, my dad, who I'd be with for the weekends, would say, like, hey, what do you want to do this weekend? Even as young as 5 or 6, it was what I wanted to do that weekend. My mom and I lived with my aunt, but again, it was a similar scenario where I could stop doing things and start doing things almost whenever I wanted. You know, I was never too constrained in terms of don't play video games till your homework's done or any of that. Things were pretty free for me. And that really is a part of who I am now, is that I was allowed that freedom.
Okay. You say you often spend a lot of time going between either your parents' places, and I believe that's why you really enjoyed the Game Boy Color and other portable games.
Yes.
Okay, fair enough. I'm going to shoot you with another heavy hitter you probably weren't expecting. I didn't ask.
That's all right. Let's do it.
Religion. Thoughts.
Thoughts on religion. Wow.
Yeah, here we go.
Well, I mean, are you religious?
No. So as far as religious as I'll get is, I'll put it this way. So I talked about this before to you guys briefly, but for a stint in high school, actually, at the end during my senior project, I learned and practiced Reiki energy healing. And I've also, you know, I've done the rounds and looked at a few religions, but growing up, religion was never meant to be. My mom is religious to an extent, and my dad, I'm not sure about, maybe not. I haven't talked to him about it recently, but both of them never really brought it up. So I never went to church, never was baptized or anything like that. So it was just kind of a non-entity in my life growing up. And nowadays, here's the thing, I'm agnostic, but my stubbornness wants to make me an atheist because my stubbornness says that even if there was a God, I'd probably have a problem with him somewhere and want to fight him. So that's generally my perspective now, is even if there was, I'd probably want to fight them over something.
Fair enough. That I guess that would be comparable to the gun theory at this point, where no matter how happy you are with the movie, you'll find a fault with somebody to try to tear him down.
Yeah, no, exactly. I'd get into fisticuffs with God over something, I'm sure.
Yeah, I'm sure. You know, the God's like, I'm going to give the Vita half a battery life. Oh, hell no. Like, okay, anyways.
Can't do that.
Did you go to college?
Yes, so I actually finished college. I graduated a couple months ago.
Where did you go to college at? Congratulations, by the way.
Thank you. Yeah, so first college I went to was this place called Hampshire College and that was right after high school out in Amherst, Mass, which was an experimental school. There were no grades, and you could make your own majors there. It was a perfect fit for somebody like me who likes doing a bunch of wild and unique stuff. And there were some people there who studied sword making. Yeah. There were people there who studied sword making. For example, all they did was forge swords at the forge and then like practice sword arts, and that was their major. I was trending towards an education of some kind in terms of a teaching of some kind, but unfortunately, just due to finances, it was a very expensive school. I couldn't stay there, so I had to leave. And then I went to Rhode Island College, which is a state school here, but not the community college. We have like 3 state schools, sort of. Right. And so it's like the mid-tier, I would say, between Rhode Island is like Community College Rhode Island, CCRI, Rhode Island College, and then URI, which is the full, you know, university, basically. And so I went to Rhode Island College for 5 years because they like to keep you there.
Wow.
And I initially was there for elementary education. I was going to be a teacher, an elementary school teacher originally. Yes. I've worked with kids a lot. I've worked as an assistant teacher in elementary schools before. And I just switched out of it because part of the program was having a problem and part just about disillusionment, because what was going on at the time was a lot of things – It was a lot more structured than I'd hoped, because I really like teaching kids and working with kids in terms of, you know, like helping them to better themselves, helping them be confident in themselves and things like that. And then, you know, teaching, dispensing lore, that sort of thing. But it was getting to the point where when we'd enter our classes, it wasn't about the kids. The classes were about, you need to grade to the, even the grading has standards. So like our grading on papers had to have certain standards that they had to adhere to. And it was just an overwhelming amount of standards. It wasn't as, I'd say it wasn't as malleable as I would like in terms of curriculum and that sort of thing. So I kind of got out of it and I went for geography. So that's what I graduated with.
Congratulations. And if you don't mind me asking, what kind of degree did you walk out with?
Yeah, so I walk out with, I think it's just a Bachelor of Arts, but it's in geography. And what I specialize in is GIS, which is geospatial information systems, basically. And
very nice.
What I do is a lot of the mapping stuff that you see on like Google Maps and things like that.
You sound like a quest giver for a game. Head down to the GIS's office and he'll tell you what to do and where to go.
Pretty much. I mean, sometimes with the sewer workers, it becomes that where it's like, we need to check out the information on these manholes.
Fair. Jeez, dude, that was not the way I was going to try to imagine it, but sure. What kind of projects do you work towards in your free time?
I mean, besides playing games, we're on it right now. So I do Into the Video Game, which is the podcast I produce with my friends. And that's been going for over a year now. And I'm also here on Casual Master Quest, of course. And right now, because Into the Video Game's, you know, going solid, we're getting good numbers, getting good deals. And that's kind of a set process, I would say, set schedule every week. I'm focusing really hard right now on Twitch and trying to grow that and get bigger on Twitch and have a good time there as well. So that's my main focus right now.
All right, fair enough. This is another big one, but I have you anticipating it. What is your favorite game of all time?
It's what I will say about this is I'm not going to say this is by any objective measure. When we're talking about my favorites, of course, I'm talking about the one that personally resonated with me, not the best design game I've ever seen, because
it doesn't even have to be a GOTY. I will not judge you. You could tell me it's Superman 64. If it's your favorite game, you know, go at it. Sure.
Yeah. And you know, because I just think I have to go with Persona 4 Golden. I could go Pokemon Blue because that's what got me into games, but Persona 4 Golden brought me back into games. And so for that, it's very important because there was a period of time late high school where I didn't mention it before. And hopefully it's not one of the questions because I do want to keep the video game persona separate from some of this. But I was very much into politics. I just don't talk about it online at all. Of course. So there was a period in high school, late high school, also early college, where that's all I did. And in terms of a hobby, I stopped playing video games. I just focused on politics. I reported news, did stuff like that. A lot of the news reporting skills I do now with Into the Video Game, I kind of picked up there. And so I kind of got out of video games, and it was just through boredom that I picked it back up and happened upon Persona 4 Golden for a chance. And I was so intrigued by it, a different thing that a video game could be from the standard fare I imagined, that I got completely back into games, became a collector, and that's where I am now.
Fair enough. You touched on it.
Background now makes sense with all the numbers and the statistics. Underground. Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Numbers. Very similar. I would love to see you with the graph, actually. I've not seen you with the graph.
It's because you haven't seen. I used to do PowerPoints at my college club, and I do have graphs. Mm. I got a lot of graphs.
You must be popular.
But not good enough. Now it's a requirement. You have to go and print out these graphs, and every week, even if it's something like...
Pie charts. Hold them up, just like...
Yeah. Hours I've spent in the last week playing game, you just put out a pie chart. Or, you know...
I mean, that shouldn't be too hard, right? With enough technology, just Google that.
Easy. I can do that.
Oh, easy, but like you have to make like the big physical charts and, you know, bring them and like have
this. Yeah.
Put it on an easel in the background. Yeah.
Yes. Exactly.
Cam, you touched on a little bit. I'm just curious a little bit. Is there any kind of political parties you associate yourself with?
So in terms of politics, here's the thing. I don't know. No. So no is the answer. I don't associate with any particular party. But when it comes to talking politics online, I want to make sure that my online persona, at least for like people who listen to individual games, stuff like that, is not associated with politics in any form, because that's a political based decision. Because if we're talking about, you know, politics and philosophy, it's political to say I'm not going to talk about politics and be apolitical or try to on the podcast. So that's my opinion there, at least. But that stuff is meant for secrets and in person, I will say. So that's one thing I will decline to answer. But I will say that I am radical in where I am. So there's not a simple way to answer that question.
Oh, I totally understand. If there's two things that can sink your career is by divulging either information about religion or politics, because there are so many diverse and very well-spoken groups that will they get really turned down if you if it turns that's out they're not the same as you.
That's why you guys should come to Canada.
Yeah, well, see, I have no problem talking about religion on here for the most part, especially what I believe. But when it comes to politics, I wouldn't mind talking about it at all if I hadn't already made the choice on my like online personas, because I don't want people to be able to figure it out either. That's part of the fun, I think.
Of course.
I want to make it like I want to keep it a secret.
I'll put it absolutely. He secretly supports Superman from this, you know, Superman 2020. Anyways, as a notable fan of the PlayStation Vita.
Oh, actually, let me go back, though, because there's one thing I definitely don't mind doing, if you want to answer, because I don't want to skip the politics question, because I feel I want to answer everything. So what I will say is I'll talk about political in the past real quick. Up until very early on in my life, in middle school, I decided I was a communist, had no idea what it was, and quickly fell out of that. In high school, I was known as Captain America or AmeriCam. I was a hardcore conservative, and I would, to the point where I had jokes about, you know, killing commies and stuff like that.
Oh, Lord.
Yeah, I had no idea.
With the older gents.
I had no idea, of course, I had no idea, you know, that's not something you say regardless, right? That's not something you say as you're going around killing people or anything like that. But so in high school, early high school, very early high school, I was a hardline conservative. Then I was a libertarian for a bit. Then I was an anarcho-capitalist for a bit. And many, many far down the line, I'm somewhere else completely. So
I was going to guess either a socialism or fascism, but that's beyond me. Do not have the detail in.
I can say I've never flirted with socialism. I have flirted with fascism.
Okay, fair enough.
In the past.
Speaking of socialism, as a notable fan of the PlayStation Vita, can you tell me what inspired you to publicly appreciate it so much when others backed away from it?
Man, I mean, that's just such a hard question. I don't know how I'd ever answer anything like that. That would be ridiculous. Oh, who could like the PlayStation Vita? There's nothing to play. I brought props for this. Okay, so that's my, I think, 33 Vita games physical.
I was going to say, for the audio listeners, Cam was very kind enough to show what looked like between 2.5 to 3 dozen PlayStation Vita titles stacked up.
I thought it would never end. I was hoping it would never end.
It looked like the opening scene from Spaceballs where you're waiting for the ship to just keep going and finally wrap up, but it just kept going for another solid 45 seconds. That was the Vita titles that he had purchased.
Yeah, it scrolls. So in regards to the Vita, so the actual reality situation is that the Vita is a great platform, and everybody who didn't jump on it, I feel, are the ones who were mistaken. And the reason for that being is that the Vita, especially with the addition of the PlayStation TV, which came later down the line, because that's one thing that really just sells me there, is the Vita was not meant, and they didn't really know what they were doing with it, but in the Western market, because it's doing great in the East, but in the Western market, what their intention was from Sony was like, oh, I guess we'll see if we can release some Uncharted's on it, maybe some Call of Duties, make it big. But the problem was the Western market doesn't like handhelds as much. And so the core gamers who like Call of Duty, who liked that sort of game, Killzone, that sort of thing, weren't looking to play handhelds. So the sales were terrible. Because of that, it became a JRPG machine, it became a Japanese game machine, and also a port and indie game machine. But that's where it shines, because as I've told you before, I really like handhelds. So what you have here is a handheld system that, of course, can like play through a majority of the God of War games, majority of Jack and Daxter games, Sly Cooper games, his collections for all of them. Metal Gear Solid games, all the big Sony franchises were pretty much all rounded up on this one system. Through digital downloads, you can play Final Fantasy 1 through 10 too on this thing. And if you're talking remote play with the PS4, you can play 11 as well.
Yes.
And 15. So in terms of just a variety of things you can get to with PSP download titles, with PS1 download titles, with all the Vita games as well, like these are all physicals here, there was just so much to offer from the library. But the one big thing that I was really interested in is Vita also is an opportunity for exploration, because you know, we often sink into, I feel, or at least I did, buying our favorite franchises over and over and not branching out really, where it's like, you know, you wait for the next thing to come out in the thing you like. And Vita for me was, I picked up the console on a whim and I was like, well, I don't know anything on here. I don't know what any of these things are. Let's figure it out, right? It's like, I know Metal Gear Solid, but what's Persona? What's, you know, Valkyrie Drive? What's Trails in the Sky? I don't know what these are. And so it was exploration in terms of finding new series, finding new types of games, and finding new genres I enjoy.
There are 2 points I want to put out here. That it sounds like you're maybe putting the PlayStation Vita to the equivalent of Pandora's box, where you open it and you discovered hope and despair.
Exactly. Danganronpa at the same time.
That is very true. And awesome. The second point I want to point out is, and this is a bit unrelated, you had mentioned before that if Microsoft would like to challenge or defeat Sony on a large margin, they would have to simply open the floodgates of money and then just douse them. It almost sounds like Sony did a similar tactic against the Nintendo DS at the time, where they dumped a lot of money, made a very high spec handheld, but then they didn't have the mid game to the end game to keep up with it. They just wanted to make a giant, very awesome handheld.
Yeah, and that's something that I think, or at least I respect, is I respect the power, because I don't respect, like, selling is one thing. You know, every console sells. If it sells well, it doesn't necessarily mean it's the best console ever, right? But
very
for
true.
Like PSP and the Vita, at the time those things came out, they were cutting edge. The PSP at the time, mind you, in like 2004, was a handheld that had graphics in between the power of a PS1 and a PS2. Nothing that the DS could even hold a candle to. The same thing with the Vita, where while the 3DS had a 240p screen, the Vita was pushing graphics between PS2 and PS3, probably like a PS2.5 even. And to see that on a handheld in 2011 was goddamn impressive.
Yeah, it was mind-boggling.
Yeah, so I respect them a lot for putting the power into it. Of course, a lot of monetary problems came because of that, but I respect the system a lot, and people who want to explore, I think, should pick it up, but there's definitely plenty of games for anybody to be interested in. Every genre, every major indie game, but yeah.
All right. You're obviously on the podcast with us with Casual Master Quest, but you started your own. Tell us about Into the Video Game.
Yeah, so Into the Video Game, terrible, terrible name. So here's what happened. So very...
You I said say, it, not me.
Yeah, oh, no, I know. It's a terrible
name. I mean, we're Casual Master Quest. We sound like an Indian flick, if you want, you know, a Bollywood film.
Every person I've mentioned the name of our show to, it's always not been met with laughter.
Well,
and I've been like, well, but you know, we're just having fun, and they're like, oh, okay, that makes sense.
It's like making a band called Hot Nightmare Candy. It's like,
that's good though. I like the name. I like Casual Master Quest. So here's the thing, right? So Into the Video Game started as very early in college, probably around 2014 or something like that. My friends and I, who, as I've told you before in the high school story, are extremely close to the point of insanity, we had always felt like, man, we should do Let's Plays. Like, we should do a YouTube channel or something like that. You know, the dream everybody has these days. But we decided basically wait until everybody has a plan in life, wait till everybody is, you know, somewhere in one place staying there. So we all graduated college. My friends graduated a couple of years earlier than I did, and they found themselves in the same area. And I found myself here for another couple of years. So I was like, guys, why don't we do it, right?
It's fantastic. And it's like it was fate.
Yeah, it's like it's fate or something. So we practice a lot. My co-founder, Sam, who's on Into the Video Game, we practice a lot for the intention of doing videos in his basement doing Let's Plays for, you know, as we started collecting 2015, 2016, 2017, doing stuff in his basement just to test things out. And I want to say 2 weeks before we started, or something like that, I made the call where I talked to Sam and I was like, I don't think videos are the way to go. I want to do a podcast. And that was about 2 weeks before we launched the whole endeavor. And we were still not sure if we wanted to do it or not. And he was like, okay, I'll do videos and you can handle the podcast. Great. E3 2017 comes along and we decided on the day, June 10th, 2017, we decided on that day to start it because we were like, okay, you know, we don't have a logo. We don't have a name, where we pseudo have a name or something like that. But we're like, it's E3. We need to jump now or never. And so we jumped, and my friend Josh, graphic designer, he just mocked up a logo for us in like 20 minutes, which is the one we have over there.
Oh, I love that.
Mm-hmm. We recorded on, we had bought equipment already for testing. So we recorded on a Blue Yeti, all laying on the floor around a Blue Yeti. And the Into the Video Game name was originally meant to be ironic because it was going to be a video series. So it was going to be like, whoa, you know, 90s aesthetic, like we're going into the video game. And of course, with the podcast reporting on news, we dropped that very quick. But the name stays, and the good thing I will say about it is all the websites were open. So nice. Now we have intothevideogame.com, which I'm happy about. Hey,
ITVG, very good choice.
Yeah, you can get a good ITVG. We use that sometimes. It's good. But yeah, that's what's going on there.
How many episodes are you in right now?
59.
59.
Yep.
You know, Kim,
a bunch of side stuff.
With that, you know, many people would usually give up on projects like this after a while. What allowed you to persevere?
Yeah, so I, you know, I've seen a lot of this too, just being around where people generally go. Actually, funny enough, a lot of people won't listen to podcasts until they're at their 20th episode or something. It's a thing because they want to see if they'll continue or not. They don't want to get invested in something and then have it drop. For me, one part, I'm stubborn, so I'm not going to give up. It's a very much a stubbornness thing, and I'm also very prideful of the project because it's my personal project. So, right, that's the thing, right? Since I took it all, I do the editing, I do the posting, I do the advertising. Because of that, it's very much tied to me. So if it stops, it's going to be because of me,
right?
And not because of any other excuse. And to that end, I'm not going to stop. So it's a fever at this point. But what's really nice about it, you know, on part on that end, part on the fact that we actually picked up some really dedicated listeners very early on who email us practically every week. And just even the couple of them, hearing from the couple of them every week in the very beginning was super helpful for that. On top of that too, you know, generally if you do something for 3 weeks, it becomes a habit. So these days I actually can't remember, like I can't remember what a time was like without the podcast where I'd have Tuesdays and Wednesdays free. So nice. It's just a thing now. It's, you know, we're in it. It's a non-hassle. We have everything streamlined pretty much. Editing only takes a couple hours. So we don't see it any reason for it to stop soon.
All right. Is there anything or any people that you want to give credit to keep you motivated and going, or for keeping you motivated and going?
Yeah. So like I said before, a lot of it is self-motivation, but definitely, you know, my family was very supportive. It was funny too, because, you know, they don't know too much about video games, but they try, you know, they try and listen every once in a while and they're like, oh yeah. And I appreciate it. But I'm also like, you don't have to, because the thing is, like, I don't like the feeling from my end. I don't want people to feel obligated to listen to it. I don't want people to feel obligated just because they're my friends to listen to it or something like that. Like, I don't care about that.
You don't want a guilt trip?
No, I want people to listen to it if they're interested in the content, because I don't want it to be anything but serious in terms of people who are listening enjoy it and not are doing it as a service to me or anything like that.
You don't want to make your grandmother listen to it out of pity or something. No. Okay, fair enough.
And my friends as well. Even my friends who are into video games. They see me enough of me. You know, they don't need to if they don't want to. But in terms of other people, I definitely give credit. We got a very early listener / writer in named Sam from New York, and he wrote us in, I think, in June or July of 2017, and it was like, you know, a month or two in, we were just getting started, and he enjoyed us. He said how much he loved it, and he'd been emailing it in. We had a couple people like that as well. Liz, a person from Rhode Island, as well as Lubos recently, a guy from Slovakia, who has been emailing in a lot. So of course my friends as well, you know, they've all been great in terms of making sure they can come on every week, freeing up their schedules. So big credit to Josh, big credit to Sam, our buddy Zach as well, who was a member up until recently when his work schedule didn't allow it. Big credit to Haley as well, who's doing a lot of our posting early on social media. So yeah, whole team, full credit. But yeah, there's a lot of motivation. It's a team effort, definitely.
Definitely. And if Cam didn't remember or mention your name, it's probably because he might be terrible with names, and he totally would. You think you got everybody?
I'm trying to think if I got everybody.
If there's someone who's like, please say my name. Please say my name.
Well, I'm thinking of motivations, right? So
thank you to all the fans.
Yeah, thank you to all the fans, of course. But yeah, no, it's the main group. The main group has always been myself, Sam, Haley, Josh, and Zach. And things have changed. You know, people have come and gone a little bit, depending on their schedules. But right now, it's just Sam, Josh, and I primarily doing episodes week to week with guests and stuff. But yeah, they were all part of the process for creating it, advertising it, getting it out there. And I still consider them part of the team. We have a team chat, and they're all in it still. So
fair enough. Since you've become a podcaster, what skills did you have to learn?
Man, a lot, actually. So one thing that was really, really nice was I used to do voice work for the morning show that I ran. So I had a little bit of experience speaking, public speaking, doing teleprompter work and stuff like that, which we don't use a teleprompter, but reading off of scripts and things like that. But that was still the most difficult part, I would say, because altering your voice and trying to get the best podcasting voice you can, you have to be incredibly, incredibly careful about P's, S's, any of the plosives. And like, if you just pee into the mic, like I'm going to do it right now, just like a strong P, you'll hear that and it'll sound horrible. And there's a thing called sibilance as well with your S's, which I do have, where on the end of your S's, it sounds like a hissing of sorts. And it's hard to change, but I recognize it in myself, and it's something I'm really trying to change. But yeah, definitely getting rid of ums, trying to get rid of buts and ums, and doing things like that. Just giving a pause, basically, if you need to think of a thought. But one thing outside of the voice work itself that it really got me into was understanding and trying to do self-promotion, which I really don't like, but you have to do it.
Right. You got to be selfish when it comes to doing that.
I do feel bad about it. But even more so than that, one thing I really appreciate about it, and I would honestly say everybody should really get in this habit, I think, is try and do your best to support your friends, at least in a sense. I know I said that people shouldn't feel obligated, but at the same time, I do want to say that nothing's opened my eyes to the amount of effort put into something versus the results as podcasting, where, you know, we'll put days, weeks of our lives, you know, 8 hours. We used to edit for 8 hours. So we'd edit eight hours on an episode every single week. And, mm-hmm. you know, the numbers were still very low, and even from local people. So my opinion now is that if I see a friend making something, generally I'll try and click on it, unless I'm like incredibly busy or something like that, or I'm not there at the moment. So I'll generally try and click on something, at least to give it a view, at least to give it just, you know, leave the tab open on a Twitch stream or something like that. Because I think it was really tough to see that, you know, people are trying real hard to do stuff and they don't get stuff off the ground. So that's one thing I do appreciate now, I think, more so than I did before.
Is there any skills that you had that you were, you know, it helped you a lot that you wouldn't have thought otherwise to use?
Yeah, so definitely I like talking. So that's something that's definitely helped a lot with podcasting.
Helps really?
Yeah, definitely. Helps on streams as well, too, because generally on the streams, we don't stop talking. I don't stop talking, even if I'm alone for like more than 10 seconds. So it really keeps stuff going as well. Besides that, kind of just what I talked about, I did a little bit of voice work previously. So
When it comes to podcasting, was there any red flags you had to deal with, or you want to warn us or anybody that's looking to get into it?
Yeah, definitely. So for starting off on podcasts, no, the one thing that I did, of course, the red flag for me was political stuff. That was one of the main ones where even if to this day, if we have a guest on and we do warn them, try not to get political. But if a guest does say something that's political to one way or another, we generally will cut it. And we'll try and keep it as apolitical a podcast as possible, unless it's like about the industry itself. That's the one exception we have, because the thing is, you're going to alienate half your audience, depending on statistics, right?
But you might alienate
immediately a bunch of people if you take a hard stance. And of course, that can be a choice you make if you want to say from the beginning, I only want to cater to this specific audience, because going for niches is a thing. But if you're trying to cast a broad net, probably not the best way to go. And I would say too is don't ever show until you're bigger. And this is a thing, but don't show how few viewers you have when you start. So don't, if people ask, try and, you know, not avoid the question, because you shouldn't lie or anything like that. But maybe, you know, if somebody asked you directly, I'd say answer it. But I wouldn't go out posting like, oh, we've had 5 listeners this episode, right? Right. I think that starting off in podcasting, you do want to give listeners the impression that you're professional. You want to give people the impression that you're, you know, big guy doing big stuff. And so unless it's directly asked of you, I wouldn't go around and posting as like about how well you're doing. And I wouldn't try and publicly be dismayed about your numbers either.
Absolutely not, because then people are going to assume you're trying to use that as a guilt tactic.
Yeah, yeah. You'll try and use this guilt tactic, or you're only in it for the money or views or getting popular or something like that. So it's definitely, I think that's my biggest one, is don't show your weaknesses, basically. When Absolutely. You're starting a podcast, don't show your weaknesses.
Follow up to that. What are your main motivations for the podcast?
Yeah, so like, maybe
for all the projects that you're working on, like your Twitch, your podcast.
So main motivations. So I'm definitely, you know, there's a little bit of selfishness in there for sure, if I'm being completely honest. A lot of it, though, primarily was the idea that my friends and I know a lot about video games. We talk about it. We do this often. So the idea was we can make something just by recording ourselves practically. And of course, it ended up being much more involved than that. But the basic premise was we could just record our normal conversations talking about companies and developers and it'll be perfect. And
Absolutely. So
that was one of the ideas. But then from that, it kind of became a thing where it was like, I really like having, whenever I get in a hobby, I like getting really deep into it. So even my like tertiary hobbies, things like that. So like anime is not my primary hobby. Here's a good example. So
really? Games,
no, it's games, your lifestyle.
Video games aren't my primary hobby. I watch anime, but even though just enjoying anime, I still was like, I want to make sure I'm watching like 10 shows every season. I want to make sure I get through a tons of series and understand the medium to an extent. So I like getting deep with my hobbies, no matter what they are. And so this was just another way to do that too, where a lot of my friends in college and late high school were artists. And so they were able to create stuff, you know, they created plays, they created art. And I was never good at creation of things. I could only talk very well and entertain a little bit. So it was also really nice to make a product from my perspective, to actually finally be making something that people can consume and enjoy. And then from the more selfish side of things, it's definitely a, partially a thing where it's like, hey, you know, in the future, I'm not going to put it out of the realm possibility that we get big to a point where we can, you know, potentially monetize to a sense. And that way we can do more of it and fund the lifestyle, because I really like being the video game lifestyle. Like I said, I hate formality, so I don't wear a suit at work. I hate suits. I don't want to ever wear a suit. I generally try and get out of it at like even weddings and things like that. So I want to be able to live as myself and live the life I want to live. And to do that, I want to do stuff like this, I should say, to maybe try and offset it so I can do more of that and less of the, you know, work grind office man stuff.
I understand that.
That's the selfish motivation, is I very much dislike the 40-hour office work week culture, and I completely will not do it. I refuse almost to do it. So,
Just to put it into a lighter mood real quick, what's a game? Well, actually, this is going to make it worse. What is the game you've tried playing, but after so much, you decided it wasn't worth finishing?
Yeah. You know, I don't drop games too often. There are a couple. Usually my rule is when I start a game, I only buy a game if I intend to finish it generally. And so if I do start it, I'll kind of force myself to finish it before the next game. There's only a couple I dropped, and one, Assassin's Creed Unity, which everybody knows the joke about that if you're in the video game world, where it was so buggy at launch and so all over the place that I put maybe 40 minutes into it and was like, no. But one recently that really for no particular reason got me was Ni No Kuni 2.
Really?
So, Revenant Kingdom. Yeah. So I put about 27 hours into Ni No Kuni 2, and it's about maybe a 40, 45 hour game, an RPG, JRPG right up my wheelhouse. And I wasn't even playing anything primarily at the time besides it, but I just kind of fell out of it and have not jumped back, and I don't intend to. And it's really rare for that to happen. I'm not too sure what about the game got that to happen. I mean, the gameplay wasn't too engaging to me, but I can't give a good reason for it. I just did not want to be there. I think part of the purpose for it was that the story itself was, it wasn't about the characters, it wasn't about the story. It was a storybook story, like a fairy tale storybook story. But the characters would come in, you'd meet them, and then you'd never see anything else about them ever again. They'd just be in the party, and there wouldn't be more like development or anything like that. So I just kind of was like, nah, not for me.
All right, fair enough. Cam, you're single, aren't you?
Yes.
Have you ever been in a relationship before?
Never. So I've, I've had some fun. I've had some fun once.
Relations of a different kind. Yes.
I've had relations of a different kind, but I've never been on a date, and I've never had a relationship, mostly from my own choosing. I've been propositioned 3 times. So okay. That is the thing. I've been propositioned 3 times, but I have not accepted those. Mostly because I enjoy like my semi-solitary lifestyle. Like I really like being alone a lot of the time and having alone time to play games. I'm very busy as it is between all my projects, so I don't know if I'd really have time for that. For me, here's the thing. Like I grew up as an only child, as I might have said before. And, you know, I have my own room, have my own independence. So I've always kind of lived alone. So the idea of being with somebody to an extent for that long period of time, like my ideal relationship, mind you, I would have no problem being in one. But my ideal would be like we meet up once a week and like watch some anime, play some games and sleep in the same bed. Don't even necessarily do anything beyond that. And then I'll see you next week.
It's funny you should say that, but that it's for a different time. The life of the truck style, or the life of a truck driver, might be for you, in fact.
Hey, man, all I'll say about that is it's on my list as like a third, like a thing I would do if other things don't pan out. It goes like, if everything else doesn't pan out, it goes like truck driver and then night overnight security guard in terms of lifestyles I would live. That'd be totally fine with living.
Okay.
So it is something I've considered. But yeah, in terms of relationship, I would be interested in one. That's the thing, right? A lot of people, I like joking about it because I like self-depreciating humor a lot. Banner is really big in my family and really big with my friend group. So I like the idea of, and we always joke about like, you know, Cam's asexual and that sort of thing. But no, like it's something I would definitely enjoy, but I'm very particular and it'd have to be a sort of thing where it's like almost not a no strings attached necessarily, but just like, oh yeah, meet up once in a while to hang out, and then that's pretty much it.
Something low commitment.
Yeah, low commitment, but the thing is, emotional commitment can be high. That's fine. I like being emotionally engaged with people, but it's really just the time and the day thing that gets me.
Okay, you did invite me to be a little bit more open about my questions.
Yeah.
Is there a sexuality you identify as?
Yeah, I am straight for the most part, yes.
Okay.
I like that.
I say for the most part because, it depends how you want to classify it. So I, of course, am identifying that way. Like I'm attracted to the female body. But that being said, the one time I did have a fun time, we should say, it was with somebody who then later came out and identified as, transgender. Yeah. Well, no, gender fluid. Sorry. Gender fluid. Okay. So at some times that person would identify as a male, sometimes a female.
It's quite the landmine topic if you're not like completely fresh onto identifying the terms.
Yeah. Luckily, where I've been and where I've been around in life is gets me on top of the turns generally.
Well,
So that's why I say for the most part, because it depends on how other people classify that. But all I'm saying is
for people to come to Canada, because if you offend somebody, you just say sorry and then it's all forgiven.
Yep. All I will say is that person had a part that would be considered traditionally female is what I will say.
Okay, fair enough. Yeah. Well, as a married person, I'm not allowed to say anything otherwise, but you know, that's okay. You choose yourself, but I am moderately disappointed. Anyways. if you could interview any video game industry rep for half an hour, who would it be?
Ooh, see, you could go for the easy ones, right? You could go for like, oh, I want to do Satoru Iwata or something like that. But I was thinking about it, and I think I actually would want to interview Phil Spencer from Microsoft. And the reason why is because I have a lot of respect for Phil Spencer, and what he did was Don Matrick was the previous head of Xbox before Phil Spencer, and he was the one who did a lot of the, you know, driving Xbox 360 to the ground with Kinect and all of the, you know, always online stuff for the Xbox One. He was the guy who did all of that. And then Phil Spencer came in and turned it all around. And he seems to, you know, he actually play games and actually be engaged with games. So I'd love to get a candid sit down with him and just be like, how did you turn it around? Like, how did this occur? What was the thought process of the Microsoft employees at the time under Don Matrick? Like, was this his idea? Was he pushing for this? Was everybody, were you a light, like a more light in the darkness who was like, guys, we should make games for core gamers? Like, I really want to know what happened in that transition there. It's just a topic that interests me. So I'd love to interview him. If I could be critical, if it was a critical, like, I'm interviewing you to make you understand something and get answers, probably Masuda over at Game Freak, Junichi Masuda, who works on Pokemon, because I'd want to aggressively and semi-angrily question him on why he's trying to make Pokemon a mobile game. Because yeah. I feel like I could tell him things.
I agree with that.
I don't know how
I very much agree with that.
I feel like I could tell him things that would give him a good perspective, and I'm not too sure.
I pay to watch that happen, Ken.
But I feel like I could be like, dude, listen, like, you're trying to make games for a mobile audience. I know you're afraid of mobile games. I know you are. You're afraid of apps. But you have a core audience of like 15, 16 million people who buy your games every time. Why aren't you making games for them? Like, come on, man. And yeah, so that's my hardcore one. If I had to grill somebody, it would be him.
Oh, man, that would be frightening. I feel like he would look at you blankly after the translator, like, you know, said the bit, and he would just stand up and leave. But I suppose if you like chained him to the chair, which we would never suggest that, no sir or ma'am.
I would.
Okay. Anyways, do you speak any foreign languages?
Yeah, a little bit. Hi, watashi wa nihongo wo skoshi hanashimasu. Yeah. So a very little bit of Japanese.
Okay. Okay. Yep. Yeah, Japanese is a little bit. Nah. Demo. No. That's pretty much all the questions I have on my end. Nick, do you have any in yours?
Not a question per se, but my only observation is that Cam is very much very much in the wrong time period and also in the right time.
Okay, I thought you were saying in the wrong. I'm like,
in
wow.
In the wrong. I'm like, no. Let's go.
No, I'm not about to start all of that. No. In the right time period because of the video game stuff.
Right, right.
But just like your outlook on things, I very much believe you belong in a Hemingway novel or I'm trying to think of the name of that. They did a movie on it. I can't remember the name of the book. We read it, but they travel
and Harry Potter.
In a beat down car from one end of America
Harry
to the
Potter
other.
Harry Potter 2, Chamber of Secrets. There was
no, not that one. No,
yeah,
that,
I'm like, this is an anime. I can't
go back in time. Prisoner of Azkaban.
No. But basically, Camp belongs in the 60s. Right, yeah, where that's what I feel like. We're 60s, like 70s. Where
I see what you're getting at, like, though. Well, see, my perspective on it, though, is because I'm a stubborn person, right? My perspective on it is I don't care what time period it is. I'm going to make it work. You know what I mean?
No, of course. So, I feel like it'd make it work regardless. But just like very much part of that Woodstock mentality. Woodstock crowd.
Yeah. I do have one final question to wrap it up. Mm-hmm. Is there anything at all that you can think of that you'd want to tell your friends, families, fans, anything?
Ooh.
One big shout out that you could possibly wrap up to send out to the world.
Yeah, you know, I think what I'd use this to say is to, I'd use this probably, because of course you could just do the like, thanks everybody, but I would want to do this to say a little something about how I treat things, because I'm not sure a lot of people like know this or don't or believe this necessarily, but generally like the things I'm talking about, the silliness I am when I'm talking about the banter and things like that, when we're talking about, you know, all the jokes about like, that's not anime, I don't understand, like, generally everything I say, like, I'm a joking person, I have fun with things, but I'm serious about practically everything I'm saying. So like, where it's the joke we've had before, I talked about on a stream once, where it's I'm not a nihilist, but I like the idea of a happy nihilism, where we're to the point of just like, we don't really care, we're just gonna kind of be ourselves. So like, the front I have isn't really a front in terms of it being like a wacky, you know, being wacky, being goofy, joking about this stuff, you know, openly talking about like hentai or whatever.
That's, real life facade.
Yeah, that's all completely serious. Like, that's all 100%. Anytime I'm talking into the video game, that's 100%. So like, the only thing we obfuscate really is political stuff, because we want to keep it apolitical. But beyond that, this is 100% real. And when you see stuff like this, when you see me on stream, that's all 100% real. So I'm not putting up any persona or anything like that. That's just how I am generally. And you can even hear the inside jokes of my friends on situations like that, because, I say everything about it openly, where it's like, the one thing I'm terrible at is responding to messages. So if people send me messages, you guys might have seen this a couple times, sometimes I just won't ever respond unless you ask me a specific question. And then sometimes even still, I won't respond. So like, that's all like 100% genuine. It's not malicious or anything, but I would use that point to kind of say like, now I'm being real with pretty much everything I'm doing. So don't think there's any front or anything like that.
Fair enough, ladies and gentlemen. That was Cam. Cam can be found on Twitter at Cam's Collects. The interviewers were, of course, myself at Tyler Vitito, and then Nick at LR Warrior 11. Don't worry, guys. For those who are listening after the live show, obviously you heard it after our main show this week. However, those who are listening live, you will be seeing us very soon. Over in about 10 minutes, we'll be starting the main show. However, this is it for this one. That was Cam. That was Nick. That was myself. That was the interview of Cam. Hopefully you understand him a little bit better.
And yeah, thanks for this, guys. This was fun.
Absolutely.
We'll see you guys next.
It was wonderful to understand you a little bit better, because any single time I can get a deeper look into the people I work with makes me happy. Because sometimes it's scary, the unknown variables, because you don't know what's going to happen. And maybe you'll find out something about them that you won't like. But honestly, I'd rather know.
And yeah, as a final word for me, in terms of what I was saying at the end there as well, as you saw here, I mean, I had no problem answering like sexuality questions, things like that. So what I really want to stress is that I am a complete open book when it comes to everything. So just literally ask me anything, and I really will not take offense to it. You would have to try very hard to offend me, and it probably won't work. People have tried for years at a time, and it doesn't work. So.
Right. You can find his work over at Into the Video Games, which is also his... that's his main podcast right there. If you want to check out his work streaming, it can be twitch.tv/camcollects.
Hey.
Anyways, enough shilling on my end. That was the side quest for Casual Master Quest. Let's start the main show soon. And don't forget to never stop the grind. See you guys later.
See ya.
Bye-bye. Love you.